championship belongs to the Los Angeles Lakers.
Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome. And the Lakers have evened their round one series with the Phoenix Suns. One game apiece. They have now stolen home court, heading back to LA. But here's the thing. This Lakers team is still not firing on all cylinders. There is room for improvement. And that is really exciting. Joining me to talk about it is Matt Peralta from LakersNation.com. Matt, how are you doing, man?
I feel excellent after a Game 2 victory. It was much needed, especially after that poor Game 1 performance. So I'm really excited heading into Game 3.
So here's the thing. The Game 2 performance, obviously they got the win that they needed, but I felt like the Lakers, if they look back in that game, they're going to look at a number of mistakes that they made out on the floor that had they cleaned up even a few of those things, they would have cruised to a win in Game 2 against the Suns instead of having to kind of fight it out in the fourth quarter. And that I'm looking at this on the positive side. I'm looking at this team thinking this squad has not even scratched the surface of their potential. Their ceiling is so much higher than what we've seen so far, and they still got the win.
Yeah, I think Anthony Davis said it in his post-game presser yesterday about how he feels like the Lakers are still finding their stride and are going to keep getting better as the series and as the playoffs go on, and I think he's absolutely right. There were a few instances last night where I thought, oh, that's a little weird, that's a miscue, or, you know, that was just a misrotation, stuff like that. You know, I think they're still ironing some things out, especially because Frank Vogel hasn't really settled on a playoff rotation quite yet, so there is room for improvement for sure. But we'll talk about this, but I think most of the improvements are going to come on the offensive end for sure.
Yeah, I mean, look, there's always going to be mistakes, right? Both sides are going to make mistakes in a basketball game. That's going to happen, right? That's sports. But I thought that there were enough things out there that the Lakers can fix just with practice, just with repetition, just with having that experience, that I'm optimistic that this team is going to get better and better and better. And here is what Anthony Davis had to say. He said, we're getting better each game. We're getting better. We're still figuring things out, still figuring out the rotations. Trez didn't play tonight. Markieff did. So we're still playing with lineups. This is how it's going to be. And the good thing about it is we can do that. We can do that because we have a lot of guys that can play in these types of situations, and we have played in these types of situations and stay ready. It's a good problem to have, but we're continuously getting better and learning each other more and more each time we step on the floor together. So when you add all that up, We're talking about a team that just hasn't had that much experience on the floor yet together. I mean, Anthony Davis was hurt for a while. LeBron was hurt for a while. But the exciting part is if they can weather this storm early, if they start to really click in the next week or two, like their growth can be exponential. They can just keep growing and growing and growing as they get more familiar with each other. They're almost, not quite, but almost a brand new team stepping on the floor together for the playoffs because they've had so many guys out hurt for most of the season.
Yeah, it certainly feels that way, right? Some of the lineups that we just haven't seen some of those lineups throughout the year. And again, it's attributed mostly due to injury. So it really does feel like the Lakers have a new team each time they're out there. They've got their core pieces, obviously, but how Frank Vogel decides to mix and match the rest of the rotation remains to be seen. But it is really encouraging to see them pull out a win like this, even though they're still figuring things out. And like you mentioned, I think things get better as the playoffs go on because they'll have a better idea and a better sense of how to play together. And I think that's going to be really key. But defensively, they were great last night. They held the Suns to only 102 points. I think they're going to be leaning on that. It's really, again, the offense for me where we're going to see the most improvement going forward.
So I want to talk about the offense and where we could see improvements there specifically. But the thought that keeps popping into my head is Jared Dudley is right. I mean, this is Jared Dudley responding to all those teams who were tanking, talking about the Clippers and the Nuggets, who were doing everything they could to avoid the Lakers in the playoffs, right? You've got the Nuggets throwing that final game against the Portland Trail Blazers because they didn't want to wind up playing the Lakers in round one. You had the Clippers dropping two games to two of the worst teams in the NBA so they could drop out of the Lakers' side of the bracket and down to the four seed. And currently they are, what is it again? Oh, they're down 0-2 to the Dallas Mavericks right now in their series, dropping both their games at the Staples Center. So you've got these teams who went out of their way to avoid the Lakers. And Jared Dudley said they shouldn't be doing that. They should be trying to get the Lakers in round one because if anybody's going to beat us, now's the time. As we get our legs under us and get more experience, we go deeper in the playoffs, we're only going to get better. And it sure is looking like he's right. And I think that's really exciting.
Yeah, we were also agreeing with Jared Dudley's comments because like we said, the Lakers are going to be at their most vulnerable right now. They're figuring stuff out. They're getting back over injuries. They just haven't had time to acclimate together. So really, it was kind of counterintuitive for the teams you outlined to tank, because really they should have been trying to get the Lakers as early as possible. So that's what we're seeing now. So credit to the Suns for, you know, paying homage to the basketball gods and playing the game the right way instead of tanking down the stretch. You're kind of seeing it now in the other series where they've dropped games, in the Clippers case, both games in Staples Center. And by the way, don't worry, Lakers fans, we'll get one of the LA teams will get a win in Staples Center this week. So that's good to hear. But as far as the offense goes, yeah, I mean, it sounds redundant at this point, but we keep saying it and we're going to keep saying it until it happens. They just need to make open shots. Yes. I'm sure someone will probably dig this up, but there were several open looks that the Lakers missed from deep last night that they could have absolutely hit, and that would have pushed the lead a lot further, and they probably could have cruised to a win. So someone did bring this point up, and I thought it was a good one, is that this is the first time a lot of these Lakers shooters are playing in a hostile road environment, because like we saw last year in the bubble, it was a neutral site, so they didn't have any of that. So maybe that's some of the factors that are coming into play. So maybe the shooting picks up when they get to Staples Center, but really I think the offensive struggles are going to be attributed to them just having to hit shots when they're open.
Yeah, I think that you're on the money there, Matt. When you look at the defensive side of the ball, sure, there were some occasions where we had two guys rotate to one cutter. Right, and that would leave somebody open for three. That happened a few times in the game last night. But again, defensive miscues happen because good offenses force defenses to make decisions over and over and over again until they make a mistake, and then they try to capitalize on that. On the offensive end, though, we've seen some periods where the Lakers look pretty stagnant, especially with LeBron James off the floor. And that's where I think we're going to see the most growth and the most improvement. You mentioned the shooting already. I think that's going to be critical, because in terms of opening up the floor, the Suns right now are doing what every team should do against the Lakers, and that is dare them to beat them from outside. Right? We've seen this for over a year now. You go all the way back to last year's playoffs. You go back to the bubble, the Portland Trailblazers. That was their game plan in the very first series. Round one was pack the paint, make the Lakers shoot, and beat you from outside. We're seeing the Suns do that. And it would go a long way if you could see some of these Lakers role players, Kentavious Caldwell-Pope, Caruso, Kyle Kuzma, some of these other guys, maybe your boy Wes Matthews, knock down a few three-point shots. That would go a long way towards unlocking the defense and opening up the paint for the Lakers. So I do think, as simple as it sounds, knocking down open looks might just be all the Lakers need in order to hit that next level.
We were joking about it in our group chat yesterday, but Trevor, you and I combined to hit the same number of threes that KCP, Caruso, Wes, and THT attempted last night. So I think that just goes to show you that there is a room for improvement in that department. But like you said, the long LeBron minutes have been pretty brutal offensively. I know the Lakers like to turn to AD in those moments, but those often result in isolation post-ups, which aren't the most efficient play for him. So I think there's going to be some room for improvement there. I think Frank Vogel will tweak that and, you know, try to get AD more on the move, maybe in more pick-and-roll situations. Maybe you see more Dennis Schroeder handling the ball and running pick-and-rolls with AD there and generating shots that way. So I think there are methods for the Lakers to get better offense when LeBron's off the floor, but it really just does come down to them hitting shots. If they can keep defenses more honest, I think the Lakers would have a lot more room to operate offensively, and then they'll just snowball from there. This really shouldn't have been such a hard game given the quality of looks they got, but because they couldn't hit anything, Phoenix was more than happy to sag off them the entire night, and that's not going to change until they can prove they can actually hit an open shot.
And I think, and this has been kind of the notion for a long time around the NBA, has been that your stars are your stars no matter where the game's played, right? Your stars are going to be your star. Whether it's home, road, typically doesn't matter that much, right? Your stars are going to show up. It's the role players that seem to be impacted more by the road environment. Those are the guys that struggle a bit more, which means I'm anticipating better shooting at Staples Center tomorrow night. I think that's going to be a big key for the Lakers. You get some of those guys to knock down some shots, and that can definitely swing things on the offensive end. Again, the Lakers aren't going on these like huge scoring runs or anything like that. They're also shutting down the Suns, though. They're doing a nice job preventing the Suns from going on big scoring runs, but you knock down a few shots here and there, and that could make all the difference in terms of opening up that defense and opening up driving lanes. So I'm really excited to see what we do there. Anything that you see rotation-wise that the Lakers are going to adjust between Game 2 and Game 3?
Yes, I think we're going to see more Marc Gasol for sure. If you like stats, I'll throw you one out here. The Lakers are undefeated in this year's playoffs when Marc Gasol actually plays. So I think at this point, he's earned some minutes from Frank Vogel. I thought the Lakers offense looked a lot better with Marc out there. Obviously, Phoenix was happy to put him in pick and roll situations, high PNRs, and then get him moving in space, which was kind of detrimental in the second half. But I think offensively, he's more helped that way because he spaces the floor like he's been doing all year. He moves the ball. He just knows how to get guys set up. So I think Marc is going to see more play time. I'm honestly a little surprised we didn't see any Trez at all, but given Frank Vogel's insistence on only playing one big, I guess it makes sense. So I think we'll see more Mark this series. I also think we'll probably see less THT and maybe more Wes Matthews, especially if he can start to get going also. But as far as the main rotation goes, I think it'll stay the same. Also, Markieff Morris got some spot minutes, and I thought he did some things out there as well. So if the Lakers are intent on keeping some size but still wanting to keep a stretch four out there, I think you do see more Keith. So in reality, I think what I'm saying is that you're going to see more of the veterans play this series, and then maybe we'll adjust the next series. But for this one in particular, I think we see more Mark, probably more spot Keith minutes, and then maybe more Wes Matthews if he can make some shots.
I mean, really, if Markieff Morris can make some shots, he'll probably get minutes. If it's Wes Matthews, he'll get minutes. Frank Vogel right now has got to be talking with his coaching staff and just saying, who can knock down a shot for me? Who can come in and hit something? And whoever that is probably going to get minutes out there. But again, the exciting part of all this is they're missing these open looks and they still won the game. Like, there is a lot of potential here on this squad as they get more used to each other. And if there is a positive regression to the mean and they start knocking down some of these shots, they could really put a stranglehold on this series. Again, gotta do the work though. Gotta hit the shots, gotta still create good looks, and it's gonna be on the Lakers to continue doing that on Thursday in game 3. Matt, thanks so much for hopping on here. I'm excited about this team moving forward, optimistic, and I know that's right in your wheelhouse.
Oh yeah, Matt the Optimist is very optimistic, especially heading into game 3, so let's see what happens tomorrow night.
All right, guys, give us your thoughts in the comments down below. Has this team, do you agree with us that this team has not scratched the surface of their potential just yet? Again, fire off those comments down below, and don't forget, subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel and ring that notification bell as well. Get notified every time we have a new video coming out. Till next time, see ya and stay safe.